One issue that is not debatable is that we want to experience what we really want to experience, and not just what we want to experience. What we want to experience comes from belief. What we really want to experience is beyond belief. So therein lies the crucial distinction, and there's no debate between belief and what is beyond belief. What is beyond belief knows that it is real, and belief merely believes that belief is real, or at least is more powerful, more real than reality, or will become more real than reality. And the only question that belief has is when that will happen. And the answer from beyond belief is that it will never happen. So there is no debate. There's no challenge to truth. No competition. Truth is true, always will be true. Belief is belief, always will be belief. Belief believes that belief is what we want. But we know there's something beyond belief, and that is what we really want. We do know that. So our purpose is to experience that which we, that feeling of what we really want. It's there. It's there. Time and time and time again, we probably faintly touch upon it. It's there. There's something there that feels complete in itself. Doesn't require the future, doesn't require time, doesn't require to be added on to, doesn't require to be augmented, to be increased, to be polished, to be perfected. It's whole, it's complete, it's total. It's there, and it's there. And so why aren't we experiencing that? That is the question we need to keep coming back to, asking ourselves over and over and over again. Why aren't we experiencing that? And there is a way to look at the situation to see what the problem is. There is a problem. We can take a look at it. And we can get closer and closer and closer to finally experiencing what we want to really experience, how we want to feel, feeling how we want to feel, instead of trying to improve upon it. See, belief automatically assumes that it's whatever we feel is incomplete. Automatically assumes it. Okay. So belief always comes on as the authority. You may feel completion, perfection, and belief will say, well, that's really good feeling. I'm glad you're feeling that, not knowing what it is at all, but just taking a completely authoritative position of saying, but you have to improve it. It must be improved. It's inherently improvable. It can't possibly be what you really want, because it's not coming from belief, because belief doesn't know what it is. So it has to be worked on by belief. So you're asked to then let belief work on this feeling for you, as if it's doing you a favor. And therein lies your fall from grace, your fall from paradise right there. That's it. It's really that simple. And the simpler you can see it, the closer you're going to get towards actually feeling this feeling of completion. And since it is complete, the only way you can lose it is to try to hand it over to belief and let belief work on it for you. And belief will believe it's incomplete and will be giving you an incomplete feeling. Belief will say, okay, here's the feeling you're feeling, and here's what I'm doing to work on it. And then you're in hell. You're in a nightmare. It's that simple. You can go beyond belief, you can step beyond time. All of that is right here now, but we keep handing it over to belief. Every moment we're handing it over to belief, saying, here, belief, work on it. You seem to know better. You have this conviction that it somehow can be made better, more complete. You know, it's like making 100% more than 100%, which isn't possible, right? So all we're doing every moment is handing over what we really want to feel to belief. That's all we're doing. It can be clarified to this point. It's being done right now. That's all that we're doing. We're handing over moment by moment by moment. We're handing over what we feel right now to how belief assumes we want to feel in the future. Assuming that belief assumes that how we feel right now isn't good enough for us. Belief will say, well, you think that it's perfect, but it's really not good enough for you because you deserve something better. See, this goes back to the belief arising from the desire to be prime creator, for spirit to be prime creator. So spirit is saying, you know, it's being spirit feels perfect, but we want to be prime creator, so we need to feel something more than perfection, something different than perfection. That's so belief, we have to look at it as the monster that it really is, as this diabolical adversary that it really is, because it's really robbing us of feeling perfect, having a perfect feeling continuously. It is robbing us of that moment by moment by moment. It is the great deceiver. It is the great bully. It is that which continuously, from every moment, bullies us into handing over this feeling of perfection we have right now and then giving back to us something that is incomplete and saying, this isn't good enough for you. You see, you don't feel good. And we need to work on this. This needs to be worked on. You need to work on how you feel. And the entire situation of the spiritual path can be simply narrowed down to just this very, very clear focus. Moment by moment by moment, we're handing over our perfection, this feeling of perfection that we have right now, all of us, everyone, handing it over to belief and saying, belief, you know better, because belief tells us we deserve better. That's what belief says. Oh, you don't realize that you're greater than you think you are. In other words, belief believes we're greater than God, greater than reality, greater than the prime creator. So whatever feeling we're getting from reality, belief will say, oh, that's not good enough for you. You deserve better. And we think, oh, really? And belief says, oh, yeah. And we're gonna give you a better feeling than this. And you just have to hang in there. There's a process of getting to this better feeling. So we keep handing over how we feel right now to belief, to time, to space, to process. That's all we're doing. Moment by moment by moment by moment, we do the same thing over and over and over and over again, and we're waiting for this better feeling to arise, and it never arises. What arises instead is confusion and fear and frustration and alienation and separation, depression, and all sorts of ways to try and overcome that. And so belief tells us it is manufacturing through this mysterious process a better feeling for us. So we all think, wow, okay, I guess it'll be worth the wait. The fact is, it's not worth the wait, because you never arrive at a better feeling than perfection. You cannot get a better feeling than what the feeling that reality gives you, because there's nothing other than reality, and there never will be anything other than reality. And our desire to be prime creator is an impossible mission. Impossible. It's mission and futility. We'll never accomplish it. There is no way to accomplish it, even though we believe there is. So the crux of the whole thing, from a very practical position, is that we, moment by moment, are handing over how we feel, like that, like that, like that, to belief. And having belief then show us what it's working on for us, which is this, you know, horrible feeling, terrible feeling, instability, horrible feeling of incompletion, instability, impermanence, sickness, aging, death, constant change, constant confusion, uncertainty. That is what belief gives back to us. And it tells us it's doing us a great favor. Because belief says, well, if you felt this perfection, you wouldn't want anything else. But by feeling this terrible feeling you're feeling, you want something else. It means you'll hang in there and just wait and wait and wait for some better feeling than perfection. It's all a scam. It's all a con. It's all ridiculous. We're just deceiving ourselves. We don't have to hand over how we feel right now to belief. We don't have to do it. We don't have to do it. You know, when we get a glimpse of how we feel right now, see, a bug just hit me right there and I just, you know, swept it away like that. We don't have to have our attention broken by the bug, just sweep it away. When we have an experience of how we feel right now, belief will say, okay, Great, but don't get stuck there. You'll get stuck. We don't want you to get stuck. So hand that over and I'll give you something even better. Belief. So that's something to work on right there. What do we do? What does belief do? Oh, belief will start singing a song or composing a song saying, hey, here's a real great song we can spin off of this, and this song will help you feel even better. Or it'll want you to do something creative, something that, you know, is replacing the feeling of right now. It'll offer substitute for it. Spend the evening singing, you know, spend the evening dancing, spend the evening dining, something like that, saying, you're on your way to something even better. Isn't that great? You're on a journey, you're on a pilgrimage. And there you go, you know. You're not feeling perfection anymore. And belief keeps fooling you like this over and over and over until you have to look at it. It's incredible deception. And we fall for it. It's kind of like the old trick. People fall for the same trick over and over and over and over again. At some point you say, you know, I don't want to keep falling for that trick. It's ridiculous. How stupid can I possibly be? Yeah, belief gets us to fall for this over and over because we desire to be prime creator. We desire to be greater than reality. So we look with disdain on the how reality feels, the perfection of reality. We say, ah, yeah, of course, that's nice. But, you know, we're headed for higher country than that. My gosh. You know, it's very common. Very common. Anyone can feel that. We're going to feel something very special. Very special, even better. And belief tells us that we have this something called specialness. We're really special. And this specialness is even better than the feeling of reality, this perfection. Because it's, and reality just doesn't get it. You know, belief says, reality just doesn't understand belief at all. Okay, so you have all this going at you every second. It's all going at you. And so, of course, it's difficult. We all struggle and we think, wow, why do I feel so bad, you know? And occasionally you'll get this glimpse of this, like a faint flutter, like of a feeling that you say, oh my gosh, that's how I really want to feel. Where did that come from? Well, it's here right now. It's never left. It doesn't leave reality. Reality doesn't lose how it feels. The experience of reality doesn't change. And we are one with reality. We are the isness, part of the isness of that is. That is reality. And so that isness always feels what it is. It's right with us right now. We're the one handing it over. Isness is not handing itself over. We think, where did that feeling go? Why did that feeling decide to disappear? It did not. We decided to hand it over to belief. And belief tells us that we don't dare get stuck in this trap of feeling perfect. Because if we do, we won't get to feel better than perfect. We'll miss out on that. We'll miss out on this amazing thing that's coming, this amazing feeling that's going to come at some point in time. We're going to completely miss out on it. And we will be we'll be completely devastated that we missed out on it. And so belief doesn't want us to miss out on that. And insists that it's looking out after our best interest. And anyone who doesn't believe that is completely insane. That's what belief says. So belief presses this belief onto us. And we have to get to the point where we just dismiss it like a bug. Like I dismissed that bug. It flew into me and I just, you know, get out. Just a bug. Just a bug. That's all it is. Just arises from the desire to be prime creator. And when we desire to be prime creator, what happens? The belief system arises and we hand over how reality feels to belief and say, here you go, belief, give us something better. And belief tells us, of course you're going to get something better, no doubt about it. And anyone who thinks that they won't must be crazy, must not believe in belief. Belief says, if you don't believe in belief, you must be crazy. Whatever that means. In other words, belief won't believe in you anymore. And if belief says, if your belief no longer believes in you, you can't have anything. You won't feel anything but a crazy feeling of loss or something. You'll be suffering total loss. No, what you'll experience is total perfection, total completeness, total wholeness, holiness. You just simply experience the feeling of holiness, meaning not missing anything, not being deprived of anything, not based needing a process to be what it is, not needing time or future to be what it is, not needing any development, any enhancement, any polishing, completion. Doesn't need any of that. You'll feel that. And then, that is what people say, well, you're feeling holiness. You're very holy, meaning you're feeling it. All sorts of bugs, moths flying all over the place here now, going attracted to the lights. Just don't pay any attention to them, really don't need to. It's like belief. So belief is this, ruthless adversary. At least it believes it is. It's not really at all, it totally believes it is. It totally believes in belief. And we really have to realize that that's the price we're paying for wanting to be prime creator, is that this ruthless belief arises, and we feel overwhelmed and intimidated and by it. There's another bug, they're all over the place. That's the price we pay. It's a terrible price, because the price we pay is we don't feel the perfection that is reality. That's the price we pay. And we pay it moment by moment by moment by moment, and we keep on paying it until we decide that price is too high to pay. And as long as we believe that belief is going to give us something better, we keep believing that price is not too steep to pay. But if we realize that belief is not going to give us anything except all the crud that it's already given us, then we say, well, that's too steep of a price to pay. Sacrificing the feeling of reality moment by moment by moment is too steep of a price to pay. I don't want to pay it anymore. So we're closing in on that now. This is October 2012. This is the time of establishing momentum, time of closing in on actually experiencing perfection of reality, how reality feels, and simply abiding in that feeling. That's all we need to do. And we need to do it. It'd be a very good idea to do it before the election, November 6th. Be a very, very good thing to do, because at that point in time, there will be this massive, activation of those who feel that this new feeling is going to happen very soon. Okay. And they will feel they just have to complete the process, whatever that completing the process is, which means they just have to become extremely activist in some direction. They will say, we've almost got it, and therefore the ends justify the means, and we can use whatever means we want to complete it, and then everyone's going to be happy, because we'll have this feeling that's better than the feeling of reality. See, that's a total deception. Total deception. So total deception is coming. Severe deception is coming. And we don't want to get caught up in that. So we want to see through the whole deception right now. And be established, abiding in the feeling of reality prior to that. That would be the wise move. That would be the very wisest move. And we all can actually do it. Because it's very crystal clear at this point. The whole situation, I've been able to lay it, it's all laid out. And we're simply handing over each moment to belief when we don't have to. We can just say, no, belief. No more. No mas. And we just have to keep practicing that. And there's various ways to do it that I brought up. So for instance, not praying for any outcome whatsoever in belief. No outcome whatsoever. You're not interested in any outcome that belief can give you, that existence can give you. None. So you're not waiting for any outcome to take place. You're not waiting for any process to take place. Because the feeling of perfection is already with us. It's not dependent on us waiting. It's not dependent on any process. So as long as we are praying for some outcome or process, we are denying how we feel right now, how we really feel right now. and we're waiting for something to occur in the future, which just means we're handing it how we feel right now over to belief. And that is never, never, never good. Just 1 second. Oh, I'll be right back. All right. So, as the time gets very close, about 34 days away, maybe even, 34 days away, we can literally get to that abiding in the feeling of reality prior to the end of those 34 days. Absolutely can. That is certainly my intention to do that. It's getting very buggy right now, isn't it? Yeah. Bugs all over the place. And those bugs will increase as we go to that election. It's actually going to get more difficult, so it's best not to wait on this. Just say, belief is not going to give you something better than how you feel right now. There is nothing that is going to give you a better feeling than how you feel right now. The future will never give you a better feeling than how you feel right now. And you may say, yeah, I feel terrible right now. That's how you believe you feel. That's not how you actually feel. Remember, belief can give us a feeling. It's how it believes we should feel. We're feeling the way that belief believes we should feel. That's how we're feeling right now. But that is not how we really feel. Not at all. It's like an overlay, superimposition. How we really feel is perfect right now. And we'll never feel better than that. There's no process that will ever make us feel better than that. The way we feel right now is the way reality feels. So there's nothing we have to do other than just refrain from handing over, each moment to belief. In other words, we don't have to establish how we feel. We already feel the way we really feel. We already feel that right now. Don't have to establish it. It's already there. Nothing we have to do in order for it to be there. It's already there. We simply have to refrain from having belief tell us how it believes we should be feeling right now, based on its mad plans for us, based on our belief that it's going to give us something better, which of course comes from us, our desire to be prime creator. We want to be better than God, better than reality, greater than God, greater than reality. And so that's what's driving this continual giving away of right now, how we feel right now, to belief. So we already feel perfect right now. This very moment, everyone on the face of this earth feels perfect right now. There's nothing that anyone needs to do. There's nothing that has to happen at all. The happenings of this world have no effect on how we feel right now. None. All circumstances of a dream have no effect on how the dreamer really feels in the awake condition, which is always there. There's nothing that needs to happen in the world for us to feel perfect right now. Nothing has to change. Nothing has to stay the same. All circumstances can remain exactly as they are, or they can change. It doesn't make any difference what happens in existence. No difference what happens in belief. None. Zero. We still feel, no matter what happens, we still feel perfect right now. We always will. And therein lies the freedom, you see, from belief. Belief is telling us how we should feel. How it believes we should feel. So, And that's what, you know, and then belief tells us all sorts of stuff have to be changed in order to feel better. And there you go. That just is the compulsion, you know, that drives existence, drives us. We need to feel better. We need to feel better. The fact is, how we really feel right now is perfect. And we don't want to change that at all. So that's already with us. It's already right here, right now. And we're just not feeling it. That's it. It's that simple. The entire thing is that simple. So it doesn't matter what happens in the future at all. Not really. It only matters to belief. Okay, it doesn't matter to reality in the slightest bit. It doesn't matter to how we really feel in the slightest bit. So we needn't be concerned about the future. Not really. Belief is concerned. Yeah. Because belief is going to change everything, and belief will, you know, is managing this vast, you know, circus. But as far as reality, how the future is going to affect how we really feel, there should be no concern at all. Zero. Zero concern. It's not at stake. How we really feel is not at stake. It's not, cannot suffer any consequences whatsoever. Cannot be changed. So, really, we really have no worries at all. So, on one hand, we need to realize that belief is really a monster, and it's about to bring about very severe changes, all propagandized to us as for our own good, that it's part of this plan, this process to make us feel even better than perfect. So, and belief has to continuously do this song and dance, and there's many, you know, the dynamic to it is actually very vicious. It's very destructive. And we've gone over that in many videos prior to this. So on that, on one hand, you have this fact that belief is ready to really stir the pot. Because it has to keep us believing that there's some great plan and process to have us arrive at feeling better than reality, and it has to happen very soon. So the changes have to be very intense and give us this belief that, hey, something really profound is happening, right? The truth is, nothing profound is happening at all to how we really feel. Nada, nothing, zero. There's zero profundity to existence. Zero. There's nothing historic happening in existence whatsoever. Nada, zero. Nothing consequential whatsoever. All, none, zero. Zero consequentiality. So exactly why do we need to be concerned about it? Okay. The only concern we need to have is that if we're going to continue to trust belief, then that is a concern. So I want everyone to feel the sense of urgency. We have to decide to go beyond belief and to no longer trust belief and to set belief aside and say no. Otherwise, belief is really going to put the screws to us and try and get us, you know, as much as possible to buy into belief even more, which we most certainly don't want to do. So there is this sense of urgency at this time. So that's what I'm saying. Even though there's no consequences, how we feel is totally unconcerned with whatever happens. There is an urgency to recognize that it is totally unconcerned. Otherwise, we may delay recognizing this, which is not a, you know, we'll continue to go be in a nightmare. And we don't really want to be in a nightmare. We don't want to really continue with this nightmare. What I'm saying is the scary part of the nightmare is about to happen. We can feel, you know, all this, like in a nightmare, you feel all this stuff coming, and you realize your stuff's closing in on you, and you say, uh-oh, you know. And then at some point, the real intense part of the nightmare happens. And then it's interpreted by belief as this is putting us over the top. So it's something very beneficial for us, which is a total lie. It's just a terrible, fearful, you know, nightmare. So we don't want that. We want to set belief aside and experience how we really feel right now. That's all. Experience how we really feel right now, which is perfect, which is complete. It is a feeling that we don't want to get rid of. We don't want to try to make it any better. We simply want to abide in it, because nothing is lacking. There's nothing missing at all. There's no feeling of dissatisfaction or incompletion. No desire to somehow make it better. So that is with us right now. As all this stuff goes on around us, all this so-called very consequential stuff in existence and belief, the feeling of perfection is simply right there. And again, it is within our grasp to stop giving it away. Stop believing that it's been given away. It hasn't really been given away, but we believe that it has. Because we want to give it away, we believe that it has been given away. I had a dream a long time ago where I had a ring, a golden ring, and I suddenly dropped it. And I heard it hit the ground and everything, and I've been searching for it ever since. Well, you know what? I always knew there was something bogus about that whole thing. I said, I don't think I really did lose the ring. And yet I saw it drop. I think I saw it drop. I believe I saw it drop. And I believe I heard it hit the ground and roll away. Well, yeah, I believed I dropped it. I believe I lost it. It was belief, because I wanted to believe it. I wanted to work on a different feeling than that, you know, golden ring. In other words, that symbolizes perfection, the golden ring. But I never did drop it. I still have it. Never lost it. It's been with me always. It's been with you always. But I believe, we've believed that we dropped it. We fumbled it, we dropped it away, and it's gone. We're looking for it, you know. And somehow, the search is supposed to ennoble us, and we're supposed to end up feeling even better than before, better than reality. But we didn't drop it. We did not drop it. We did not lose it. It still has been with us every second. I've had several experiences in life where I suddenly was aware of this feeling, and I said, my gosh, it's been with me the entire time. It's never been gone. The richness of how we really feel has always been with us. We just believe it. We've been believing that it hasn't been with us. That's all. Like a dream. But it actually, we have been richly experiencing the feeling of perfection nonstop our entire lives. We're just not aware of it. Because we believe that we're believing that we have not. And so we're believing that we've been feeling something different. We're imagining how we feel. Believing that we feel differently. That we believe that we feel incomplete. If we want to feel better, don't we believe that what we're feeling now is incomplete? Has to be, right? If we believe that there's a better feeling than perfection and reality, then we must believe that perfection is not complete. So we scorn experiencing it, and we open ourselves up then to this feeling of incompleteness. And there's really no limit to the incompleteness. Incompleteness is incomplete, right? So it's missing. It's missing. It's not stable. It's not whole. So that's what we believe our feeling is now. We've chosen that feeling because we feel in we will be able to complete it someday. It will be better than perfection, better than completion. We'll have a completion greater than completion. And yet the price we're paying is believing that how we feel is incomplete, that reality is incomplete. And so we just have this feeling of incompletion. And then are working on it. We're working on it, right? Working on to make it complete. And we believe that the future will bring us what we need to make it complete. And belief will hand us all this trauma and all this loss and death and suffering and destruction and all this terrible stuff. And we will believe that that's exactly what we need to make this feeling complete. To complete the new feeling. that's greater than perfection. But it won't do that at all. Won't do that at all. We'll keep believing it is, but belief itself is a belief of incompletion. So we'll never be satisfied with belief. And yet, that's okay, because the feeling of perfection is with us right now. It's never left us. It's never left us, not even for a second. We just believe that it's left us. Every second we believe, we're searching for it, we can't find it, we feel incomplete. Oh, where is my, you know, where is what I want? I don't have what I really want. Where is it? Where can I find it? Maybe in this car, maybe in this job, maybe in this person, maybe in this, maybe in this. And we're searching, searching, searching for the feeling that we believe we really deserve, you know, something greater than what we had before. And yet what we had before isn't gone. It's not gone. Therefore, we can be quote-unquote enlightened, or quote-unquote self-realized, or whatever term you want to use. It's still with us, right now. Right now, it's never not with us. We just believing in a future, which is not now, and that we believe somehow we're in the future. You know, our feeling is actually something that's in the future. So we're kind of living not now, we're living in the future. We're experiencing what we believe is a future. Incompletion. Feeling of incompletion. That can only be in the quote-unquote believed future, because it's not here now. It's not here now at all. What is here now is perfect completion, perfection, flawlessness. And it absolutely, we can realize this. Not as a starting point. Not as like some freakish glimpse of what we're going towards. Some serendipitous glimpse. No, as what has always been here right now. And therefore we realize we can abide in that. That it is stable. It's not slipping into the future. It's our desire to be prime creator, which causes us to slip into the so-called future, which is belief. It's just a believed in future. There is no real future. It's something that we believe in. So we're lost in this dream of imagining, just a dream of believing in the future, believing that there's something will be accomplished, you know, that something greater than reality will be accomplished in the future. So we're literally projecting ourselves into a dream-like condition of the future, but there isn't really any such future. From a standpoint of how we feel, from a standpoint of truth and reality, the perfection is right now. Everything is perfect. Everything is already perfect. Or how we feel is already perfect. The feeling of reality is already perfect. And so the very fact that we can focus on this at this time means that we're close to it. It means that we're close to seeing through this delusion, waking up from this ridiculous dream of projection into the future, and realizing that how we are accepting how we feel right now, which is perfect. And so we literally will feel this, feel perfect. If someone asks, how do you feel? You say, I feel perfect. And you won't be just, you know, saying that, you know, as a nicety, a social nicety. It'll be literally a statement of fact. You'll feel perfect. It doesn't matter how old you are, how you look, what your finances are, what your social situation, your housing situation, your job situation, your friends, your relationships. None of that makes the slightest difference in how you feel. You'll feel perfect. But what happens? You'll continuously feel perfect. You have that perfect feeling. It doesn't matter what music you listen to. where you go, where you live, anything, you'll still, no matter what, still feel perfect. And we can continue to clarify this and clarify this, and no doubt it, we will. But we don't have to go, you know, any further than the very basics, really. It's wise to just keep on focusing on the basics. Don't worry about all the so-called ramifications, etc., etc. No, it's not like that. It won't be like that. You know, the mind games that come up. How what kind of music we want to listen to? Questions like that. Don't even ask those questions. That's ridiculous. Because it's not important. Because you'll still feel perfect. So why be concerned about what kind of music you listen to? If we don't understand that this feeling of perfection, how great it is. And out of that feeling of perfection, the fact is you will... expressions of gratitude and joy just naturally flow out of that. And you will literally hear whatever you want to express. Like if you want to hear music, you can literally express it from that perfection better than anything the world can ever, belief can ever provide. Art, whatever belief can provide, you will express out of this feeling of perfection something vastly richer. Continuously, effortlessly. So it's a non-starter to ask about, well, you know, what about this? What about all the stuff in belief? Yeah, it'll be like dust. Be like dust. You will feel just a natural expressiveness, a flow of expressiveness, subtly. You don't even have to express it into belief, projected in the future. No, it's here right now. That is, there's more beautiful than anything that belief can ever come up with, vastly more. And the whole context of it, again, it all feels perfect. So we cannot, don't even compare it to anything that arises in the imagination of belief and time and becoming and process and all that. Don't even think that you have to measure it. You won't feel any need to measure anything like that. And it won't be any big deal. You know, if somebody comes up with some great song in belief, they say, oh my gosh, I've got something unbelievable. You've got to hear this. But in the perfection of the moment, right now, you realize you can come up with endless, infinite, exquisitely beautiful expressions with no effort whatsoever. And you just abide in that and it's nothing. It's no big deal at all. You handle it perfectly. You don't need to write it down. It's already with you. You're already experiencing it. And you think, what about others? Can't you give it to them? No, as long as they're in belief, they'll only experience incompleteness. That's it. It's futile. You cannot put the expression of perfection into belief. You cannot do it. Those who believe in belief will only experience belief, and belief will give them incomplete experiences of everything. So all seem incomplete, and people will say, well, where's the perfection? You say you're feeling this perfection. Where's the perfection? We're not feeling it. There is no way to give that to anybody, to give that to belief. You cannot give perfection to belief. You cannot give reality to belief. It's impossible. And therein lies, you know, a stumbling block for us. If you are in perfection, feeling of perfection, and all this unbelievable creativity, just expressiveness, is just completely effortlessly there, in all facets, continuously, and you see everybody so impoverished and feeling and crying, was our experience is so incomplete, you know, and you're feeling so perfect. Can't you give us something to help make us feel better? And you think, wow, it's completely effortless to do that. So what's the big deal? Aha! It is. It's impossible. Impossible. You cannot give the feeling of perfection and the expressiveness of that perfection and the total completeness every moment of that to belief. Put it into belief, into that context. It will absolutely lose. It will not be what it is at all. Everyone will feel as though they're missing something. They lost something. They can't find it. And it will torment them, actually. It will really torment them. So it's really better, if you have compassion, do not try and put creativity into belief. Don't try to be creative or artistic or anything like that. That really ends up tormenting people more than you can understand, really. Very tormenting, because they'll feel like they're supposed to get it. There's something there to get. They just can't quite get it. So that's why you don't see those who have awakened to how they feel right now being creative. They're not. Like Ramana Maharshi, was he composing poetry and songs and doing art and, you know, a huge outpouring of things, you know, forms of beautiful expression? No, not at all. He's simply sitting there in peace, saying, come on in, the water's fine. How you feel right now is perfect. Come on in. It'll be super, super rich experience, no problem. That's how it is, because they know. It's completely obvious that it's futile to try and place the experience of perfection into belief in any format. You can't express it in a song or in poetry or in art or in dance or anything. Technology, relationships, none of that stuff. Because that's like pouring water into a cup that has no bottom to it. You can never fill it up. You cannot fill it up. So all about is, you know, people holding their cup there, and you're pouring water in, and they're saying, okay, when is the cup gonna be full? When's it gonna be complete? And you say, well, I'm pouring it nonstop. It should be soon. They're saying it's not full yet. It's not full yet. And they'll say, well, you're fooling us. You're not really, what you're feeling isn't complete, because if it was, my cup would be full. And you should look at the bottom of the cup and you realize the cup has no bottom to it. So everyone's frustrated. Everyone's blaming. Say, hey, you're pouring bogus water into my cup. It's not filling it up. You're trying to get me to believe in a lie. You're trying to con me. You know, all this stuff rises. It's futile. It's futile. That's why those who awaken say, hey, just awaken. Forget about trying to be creative. Forget about all that stuff. Creativity of right now, of reality, is infinite and endless and effortless, and it's this flowing tapestry, and it cannot be contained within belief at all. It cannot be understood, cannot be seen, cannot be experienced, none of it. So why waste your time giving people false hopes that somehow it can be experienced in belief when it cannot? The goal is to stop giving this moment right now to belief. The goal should be inquiry. The goal should be satsang. The goal should be awakening. That should be the goal. That is the goal of existence, and that should be emphasized. Everyone should emphasize that. Don't emphasize anything else, because it's literally very simple to do, and everyone can do it. Just stop trying to give it away. Stop trying to figure a way to symbolize it. Yeah. And the goal is to abide in that feeling, not to have some breakthrough and feel that feeling necessarily. No, no. Most people have already had that breakthrough. I had it in 1978, you know. And I realize, okay, it's possible to have a breakthrough, but what I want is to abide in this, you know. And other times I've had moments of breakthroughs, but I said, that just makes things worse, really. I'm not really interested in breakthroughs anymore. I'm not interested in trying to get somebody to experience the now moment. because then it just leads to frustration, because then they think that they're supposed to carry it back into belief. And then they feel burdened and responsible, like, oh, I have to try and remember how great I felt in that moment, a high peak moment, so I can and then figure a way to express it into the world and give them this great gift, you know, so they can get a notion of how it feels and all that stuff. That's not it, because everybody already feels perfect. They just need to be explained and see what it is they're doing. Because belief will take whatever expression we give and it will just continue to present it to us as belief. So that doesn't help us at all. It doesn't really help at all. Trying to give people glimpses of threat, trying to create some sublime art, that's not it. That makes things worse. Because belief will say, ah, you see, you got this sublime art, and so you're progressing to something even greater. This is the way to do that. You know, people will say, oh, yeah, that's helping us. Now, what you need to do is abide in how you feel right now. Abide in the now feeling. Abide in that every moment, and explain to others how simple it is and what exactly is, you know, what they're doing to not feel how they feel right now, how they really feel. So that then they will abide in it also. That is how the situation has to unfold. There isn't any other way to unfold it. So those who are feeling how they really feel simply do that. They feel how they really feel each and every moment. They don't give it away. They don't give it to belief. And then they simply inform others that this is what their goal is too. This is the goal. And try to help others not get sidetracked. Don't get sidetracked. Don't try to just catch a glimpse of it. Forget about that. Don't worry about catching a glimpse of it. Do the lay the foundation so you abide in it. That's what really helps. That is what really helps. Because then people realize, ah, it's not a process. They realize, no, there's no process here at all. You're just abiding in it. There's no, you know, it's not lost. There's no process. They start to get it. That's why the great ambassadors of truth just sit quietly and abide in how they feel right now. And people see that and they look at it and they start to get it. So they say, ah, that's what I need to do. That's what will help others come to feel how they really feel, already feel, right now. And then the path becomes much simpler. You start giving up all this attempt to express it. You know, thinking, I caught a glimpse 10 years ago. I'm still trying to express it. I'm still trying to compose the perfect song that it captures that essence, you know. They'll gradually stop doing that. Yeah, I had a terrible dream last night. I met up with this person in the dream that was very terrifying. As a musician. And a very scary, scary persona dynamic there. And I was pleading, you know, for help, saying, oh my gosh, I don't want to associate with this person at all. And that is simply that effort in belief to express reality within belief. And this person is this dynamic is very adamant and ruthless and will bully you and threaten you and scare you. It's horrible, and I've experienced all this my entire life. Is because I had the experience of feeling how I really feel. This dynamic insisted that it was my responsibility to try to express this, give a, you know, expression to it, so that others could hear it or see it or listen to it, or, you know, and it feels that it's the authority over us. It's in charge, and it's ruthless, you know. It's really a very frightening encounter. And as I was saying, no, I don't want that encounter. Forget it. I want to get as far away from that as possible. And it was a great thing to dream that. That means I'm at the point where I'm able to face that, you know, ruthless slave driving belief that it in the righteousness of what it's doing, and the so brittle, you know, and set and dogmatic and determined, and believing that what it's doing is the right thing, and no one else, you know, there's no other right. This is the highest right, in all this extreme self-righteousness about belief. And here I am, and just saying, no, I don't want to try and spend the rest of my life trying to express perfection, how I feel right now. I don't want to spend my time trying to express that. I want to live it. I want to feel it. I want to be it. And then show to others that's what they can do too. That's what has to be done, that it can't be expressed. So there was this showdown in the dream, and it was very intense. Belief is very intense. Belief, again, believes that it is the authority over you, that you are a child of belief, and that you have to do what it says, and it will be vicious if it needs to be. Totally arrogant. And it sees you as a supreme threat. It views you with this feeling of it needs to attack you somehow. It's going to attack your unwillingness. That's the feeling I got, that this feeling of very determined attack, to attack my unwillingness to cooperate and, you know, to do anything it needs to do. You know, enslave me, put me in, you know, concentration camp, torture me, whatever, kill me, whatever needs to be done. Threaten me with, you know, annihilation, whatever needs to be done to gain my cooperation, you know, to try and express, you know, instead of feeling how I feel. Turn that over to belief, and then have belief tell me what sort of expression belief can believe in, that sort of thing. So, as this is surfacing, and the confrontation in the dream came up, that means I'm right there, gathering strength to set this aside entirely. Whole scenario. I don't even need to confront this dynamic at all. Not even interested. So our situation really is incredibly better than we can ever imagine. Our situation is we already feel perfect. We already are perfect. Right now, always will be. What an incredibly great situation we're in. Always. And it's a mere bagatelle to, you know, dismiss belief, really. It's just that we've been given belief all the power. We're trying to empower belief entirely over us. Give us power, belief, power over us. How can we create some power that has power over us? We're a child of the Prime Creator. We cannot create some other power that has power over us. The Prime Creator has power over us. And the Prime Creator gives us perfect freedom. That is its expression of the power it has over us is perfect freedom for us. So we cannot give anything power over us. We'd have to give something power over the Prime Creator in order for that to take place, and that's not possible. And so, and yet we have tried to intimidate ourselves. So eventually you come face to face with this intimidation, this dynamic of intimidating ourselves. And it is really quite a situation. But I'm fine. You know, I survived the day fine. A little unnerving, but didn't affect how I functioned in the day at all. And But inside, I'm kind of like, you know, it's a bit of alarm, you know, because that old intimidator is still at least carries an echo of intimidation. I mean, it carries a history, right, of just sort of all the memories of being intimidated so badly by that self-intimidation, by belief. It sort of carries the echoes of that intimidation. And so I guess confronting it is a way of shedding that intimidation. It's an inner thing. It's not an external thing, you know. It's not like you can confront some person in the world. That's bogus. That's getting off track. You know, thinking that there's some authority in the world that you, if you can confront them, you can, you know, get over this feeling. No. The whole thing, whole dynamic is internal. It's within you. It's in your own mind, your spirit. The confrontation situation is internal entirely. It's the intimidator of all intimidators. It's your own effort to intimidate yourself. It's your own effort to force you to abandon what you are. Force you not to feel how you feel. We're doing it to ourselves. So we have to internally stand up to that. It has nothing to do with anybody out in the world at all. It doesn't even have anything to do with the world. Because we're the ones who are surrendering how we feel right now to belief. And that's prior to the world arising. That's a much deeper level than the universe even. That process is going on internally within us right now. Prior to the world, each moment, we are allowing belief to present a universe to us. Think about that. So we're really imagining this universe every moment. We're greater than the universe. We're prior to the universe. Internally, what's going on? Our internal dynamics of this trying to surrender to belief every single moment. That's what enables belief to present this universe to us. If we didn't do that, belief could not present this universe to us. Instead, unconditional love would overlay the universe to us. It would present the universe to us. We'd have our how we feel right now present the universe to us. Or present all the belief in a different light, an entirely different light. The belief that somehow all of this is preventing us from feeling how we feel right now, we'd realize it doesn't prevent us at all. So everything can still remain. It just as we'd realize it has no consequence to how we feel. None. So the universe still remains, but now it has no consequence whatsoever. You know, totally inconsequential. Doesn't have any effect on how we feel at all. So we don't have to get rid of the universe. It doesn't have to disappear on us at all. We just realize, I feel perfect. I feel perfect right now. And there's only right now. There is no future. That was only projection of belief that I was trying to imagine, you know. So we can feel okay about this. We can feel okay. It's kind of a sense like, yeah. This is all very much in the ballpark. Very much in the ballpark. And that's where we want to be right now, October 2012. We want to be feeling like we're in the ballpark. Like if you've ever gone to like a baseball stadium or some stadium or some place where you park your car, you go up the escalator, go up the stairs or something, and you go into the concourse and then you go through the openings and then you're inside and you look out and there's the field. Like in baseball, you see this beautiful emerald green field. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, I'm in the park. I'm in the ballpark now. And you realize that it's very different than outside the ballpark. And it doesn't really matter where your seat is, you know. You might just kind of be walking around and just looking at the ballpark and you say, wow, I'm not exactly sure where my seat is, but I don't really care. I'm in the ballpark. That's the feeling, you know. I'm, you know, row, you know, B13, seat 15 or something. Say, well, you know, section 117, you know, row B, seat 15. Say, well, where is that? I don't know. That's somewhere around here, but I don't really care because I'm in the ballpark. That's good enough. You know, I'm in the ballpark, and now I'll make my way to my seat, but I'm feeling really good, like I'm in the ballpark. I feel very, very okay with it. That's where we're at in October right now. We're in the ballpark. We're seeing it very clearly. We're standing up to the great intimidator, the great bully, all of that, and saying, okay, nah, no mas, forget it, that's over with. I'm finished with that. So we're in the ballpark. We're seeing, we're okay with the truth that we feel perfect right now. Always have been, always will be, feel perfect right now. So now all we have to do is find our seat, and it's, you know, somewhere nearby where we will simply abide in that feeling perfect. And we'll do it before the election. We'll do it before the election. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.